Welcome to Pathology Central Key Concepts. The topic of this video is the pathophysiology of inherited metabolic liver diseases. There are three entities I'll be covering in this video, all of which are associated with increased risk of cirrhosis and therefore of hepatocellular carcinoma. In order to understand the pathophysiology of two of these diseases, I will be reviewing the regulation of iron and copper in the body. But most of this video will be focused on the pathophysiology, clinical features, and morphologic findings of hemochromatosis, Wilson disease, and alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. Now, there are several different ways that we can get iron overload of the body. This video will be focusing primarily on hereditary hemochromatosis, which is usually due to mutations in the HFE gene. In addition, we can get a secondary hemochromatosis, also known as hemosiderosis, in a variety of different contexts, such as parenteral iron overload due to multiple red cell transfusions. This is typically in the context of a patient with a hereditary anemia. In addition, there are several conditions associated with increased iron uptake, such as beta thalassemia. Patients may ingest excess oral iron, which can lead to hemosiderosis, and we can also see this in the context of chronic liver disease due to derangements in hepatocyte metabolism of iron. This excess iron can deposit in multiple tissues and organs, and we'll be describing this when we discuss the clinical consequences of hemochromatosis. So there is no regulation of iron excretion. Instead, total body iron is going to be regulated by intestinal absorption, and this will occur through the protein hepcidin, which is encoded by the gene HAMP. Hepcidin is a circulating peptide hormone that is a negative regulator of intestinal iron absorption. And the way that we regulate hepcidin will be through three proteins, HFE, HJV, and TFR2, which are membrane proteins expressed on hepatocytes that function together as a sensor for iron. Now, we don't know the mechanism by which they sense this, but we know that in the setting of adequate iron stores, they will increase expression of HAMP, leading to an increase in hepcidin production. When we get loss of function mutations of any of these proteins, this can lead to hereditary hemochromatosis, which is an autosomal recessive disease. So how does hepcidin actually regulate iron levels? It's going to bind to a protein called ferroportin, which is found on enterocytes. When it binds to ferroportin, that protein will be internalized and degraded in the cell, and iron will remain trapped in the enterocyte, where it can then be sloughed into the lumen as the cells die. Let's look at a figure that puts this together more clearly. This is a simplified version from Robbins and Kumar Basic Pathology. So we have our ingested iron, which is here, Fe3+, which will be reduced by duodenal cytochrome B to form Fe2+, which can then be transported by the divalent metal transporter 1, DMT1. Now, the iron is here within the enterocyte, and if this is at a point where this enterocyte is dying and is sloughed into the lumen, that iron will be lost from the body. But what typically will happen is this iron will be transported by ferroportin, and it will be reduced by hephaestin to generate Fe3+, which can be used by the body. Now, hepcidin is going to interact here by binding to ferroportin, causing it to be internalized and degraded. Let's look at another slide that shows this. This again comes from Robbins and Kumar Basic Pathology. Here we have our liver with our hepatocyte and these three proteins that act as a complex. Now, they are each shown as mutated. You only need mutation of one. We will not see mutation of all three. And the reason the arrow here is a little bit heavier is to indicate that HFE is the one that is most frequently mutated in hereditary hemochromatosis. With mutation of any of these proteins, we will get reduced synthesis of hepcidin, resulting in reduced circulating hepcidin. So although the hepcidin that's here can bind to ferroportin, causing it to be internalized, because it's such a small amount, most of the ferroportin will remain viable, allowing all of the iron that comes into the enterocyte to then be passed on into the blood and leading to iron overload. So how does iron actually cause injury? So we can get iron-catalyzed free radical reactions that these free radicals can then go on to cause lipid peroxidation as well as DNA damage. This reaction is referred to as the Fenton reaction, in which we have the iron ion here, 2+, added to hydrogen peroxide to generate Fe3+, plus the hydroxyl ion and the hydroxyl radical. This is a radical that can cause lipid peroxidation as well as DNA damage. With this DNA damage, we can get lethal cell injury as well as an increased risk of hepatocellular carcinoma. Iron itself can also activate the hepatic stellate cells, causing fibrosis. So what are the consequences of iron overload? So we've talked about it briefly in the liver. We can get hepatomegaly initially, which then with continued injury will lead to cirrhosis and has an increased risk of hepatocellular carcinoma. In fact, in these patients, they have a 200-fold increase in the risk of hepatocellular carcinoma compared to the general population. In the pancreas, iron overload will lead to diffuse interstitial fibrosis, which can progress to diabetes. Iron in the myocardium can lead to cardiomegaly as well as arrhythmias. And in fact, the liver and heart are the cause of most causes of death in these patients. Iron deposition in the pituitary gland can lead to hypogonadism and adrenal insufficiency. We can also see adrenal insufficiency due to iron deposition in the adrenal gland. Deposition in the thyroid gland leads to hypothyroidism, in the joints leads to arthritis, and then in the skin, particularly of the sun-exposed skin, we can see a change in pigmentation. This can manifest as a bronze to grayish mucocutaneous hyperpigmentation, which is due to increased melanin production. It's not clear exactly how iron increases melanin production. We can also see iron deposition in the dermal macrophages and fibroblasts. Now, you may be wondering how this will appear in individuals who already have darkly pigmented skin. And the issue is really not so much the absolute color of the skin, but the change in the pigment. So, for example, if you were to look at a patient and they say, you know, I feel like my skin's been getting darker, take a look at a photograph, perhaps a driver's license, to get an idea if there's been a progression. One other point I'd like to make about iron overload is that due to menstrual bleeding, females have a monthly exodus of iron. Therefore, they will be affected typically at an older age than males who are not typically losing blood frequently. This is just an example of this bronzing of the skin, which you can see. You can see that for many people, this may be their usual skin color. So it's important to compare that to what the skin looked like at an earlier point in time. This combination of bronzing and diabetes sometimes refers to this being called bronze diabetes. So what will we see in the liver? So grossly, early on in hemochromatosis, the liver will be chocolate brown in color and enlarged. But over time, with continued damage, it can become a very dark brown, almost black and cirrhotic. Microscopically, we'll see hemosiderin and the periportal hepatocytes. Over time, it will then move to involve the rest of the lobule, as well as the bile duct epithelium and the Kupffer cells. We can also see fibrosis that over time will progress to cirrhosis. Now, I'd like to take a moment to address this idea of hemosiderin and lipofuscin, because you may get the impression from your textbook that it's easy to tell them apart, because hemosiderin is typically described as yellow, brown, and granular, and lipofuscin as golden, yellow, and globular. The truth of the matter is we cannot tell simply by looking at an H&E stain. We need to use a special stain, and for that we use a Prussian blue. So let's just put this together here, just to compare and contrast. Here is showing lipofuscin, which is that wear and tear pigment that can develop in the cells over time. And yes, it does appear sort of golden brown and maybe globular, but it actually doesn't appear that different from the hemosiderin, which we can see here in this cardiac biopsy from a patient with hemochromatosis. Let's go ahead and answer the question by using our Prussian blue stain. Yes, there it is, abundant iron, so we can make that diagnosis. This is a gross image showing the liver in hemochromatosis. It has that chocolate brown color. This is an earlier stage. But if you haven't looked at a lot of livers, that may not look different from what you imagine liver is looking like. Here's an example of normal liver. And I would just like to add that over time, this is going to become darker, almost black, and cirrhotic. Here is an example of what cirrhosis looks like in hemochromatosis. Similar to what we see in other diseases, we have these nodules of hepatocytes with these broad bands of fibrosis. Let's look on higher power, and in fact, we can see there's the deposition of some sort of pigment in these hepatocytes. It's a little granular, brownish gold maybe. Here's what lipofuscin can look like in a hepatocyte. Let's not worry about what it is. Let's do our Prussian blue stain, and boom, there it is. Now this image gives me an opportunity to show you a couple of things. First of all, you can see there is really widespread iron deposition. This is fairly dramatic. But also, if you look here, this is a portal triad. It is, as I described, primarily depositing initially in that periportal area, where you can see it's a little bit diminished here at the middle of this lobule. But over time, it will progress and can fill up the entire lobule. Here on higher magnification, you can appreciate that granular appearance, as well as how diffuse it is through the hepatocyte. Most patients, fortunately, are diagnosed before there's irreversible tissue damage. This is typically through abnormal laboratory tests that note that there's increased iron. In order to make the diagnosis, nowadays we typically will do sequencing of the HFE gene. In previous generations, we did a liver biopsy, and we could actually quantify the amount of iron in the liver. Now, as I mentioned previously, there is a significantly increased risk of hepatocellular carcinoma as well as death due to hepatocellular carcinoma, cardiac failure, or liver failure. But fortunately, the treatment is very straightforward and easy. It is regular phlebotomy. By doing this, you are removing iron from the body. We follow the patient's total iron body composition, and that allows us to ensure that they do not build up excess iron. So this brings us to another disease, which is due to excess metal. This is Wilson disease, which, like hemochromatosis, is autosomal recessive. It is due to loss of function mutations of the ATP7B gene, which is going to lead to two effects. One is we will get impaired copper excretion into bile, and the other is we will get the failure to incorporate copper into ceruloplasmin. Toxic levels of copper will build up and can accumulate in multiple organs, including liver, brain, and eye. So how is copper metabolized? About 40 to 60% of ingested copper is absorbed in the small intestine and then transported in a complex with albumin and histidine to the liver. There it will bind to hepatic ATP7B, which is a copper transporting transmembrane protein. Now this protein is found in two locations. One is in the trans-Golgi network, where it's going to mediate the transport of copper into aceruloplasmin to ceruloplasmin, which can then be excreted into blood and perhaps out into the urine. It's also found in lysosomes, where it will transport non-ceruloplasmin-bound hepatic copper to bile canaliculi for excretion, and this is the major pathway for copper excretion. Let's look at a figure that puts this all together. Here you can see we have our copper intake. It's absorbed in the stomach and duodenum. It travels through the body in that complex with albumin and histidine to enter our hepatocyte. Here we have our ATP7B in the trans-Golgi network, which is going to incorporate our copper into our aceruloplasmin to form ceruloplasmin, which is how it is transported in the blood, and as I mentioned, it can be excreted. The copper can also go through this transporter into the lysosome and after that into the canaliculus for biliary excretion. So you can see how mutations in this one gene can affect these two processes and thereby prevent the incorporation into aceruloplasmin and biliary excretion. So copper is going to accumulate in hepatocytes and, like we saw with iron, generate reactive oxygen species that can cause injury. Our non-ceruloplasmin-bound copper will be released by these injured hepatocytes, where it can cause red cell hemolysis and then be deposited in other tissues, such as the brain, cornea, and kidneys. We can also detect increased urinary excretion of copper. Patients tend to present between the age of 6 and 40 years old, and the symptoms will be those of acute or chronic liver disease, so elevated transaminases, encephalopathy, coagulopathy, etc. Deposits in the basal ganglia can lead to neuropsychiatric symptoms, and deposits in Descemet's membrane of the cornea can lead to kayser-fleischer rings. So let's look at an example of that. Here you can see this brownish deposition here in the cornea. This is something which you probably will not see in the clinic unless you are a hepatologist or an ophthalmologist, but it is a finding that is frequently seen in shelf exams and board exams, so worth keeping an eye on, so to speak. How will the liver appear? It's going to vary in appearance depending on the stage of that particular liver. So in acute hepatitis, the liver will be swollen and enlarged. If the patient develops fulminant hepatitis, there will be massive necrosis leading to a shrunken small liver. And with chronic hepatitis, over time we can develop cirrhosis. Microscopically, again, the features will depend on the stage of the liver. So with acute hepatitis, we'll see inflammation, hepatocyte ballooning, acute cholestasis, whereas in fulminant hepatitis, we'll see confluent hepatocyte necrosis, which can lead to parenchymal collapse. In chronic hepatitis, we can see steatosis, lipofuscin deposition, chronic inflammation, and using special stains, we can identify copper. With time, this again can develop into cirrhosis. Here's a special stain showing the copper deposition in the liver, helping to confirm the diagnosis for this patient. So diagnosis is based on identifying decreased serum cellulioplasmin, increased hepatic copper, which is the most sensitive test, or increased urinary copper, which is the most specific. We then can also sequence the gene to determine the mutation. Treatment includes copper chelation therapy with D-penicillamine or trientine, zinc-based therapy, which can block copper uptake from the gut, and in patients who develop cirrhosis, liver transplant may be necessary. This brings us to our final disease, alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. So this is, again, an autosomal recessive disease, and what we see here is a misfolding of the alpha-1 antitrypsin protein with loss of function. The typical function of this protein is to inhibit proteases, such as neutrophil elastase, cathepsin G, and proteinase 3, which are released by neutrophils at sites of inflammation. With this deficiency, we will get unopposed activation of neutrophil proteases without any extinguishing. So what is the pathogenesis of this disease? We know that there are more than 75 codominant variants. The terminology we use is PI for protease inhibitor, and then an alphabetic letter to denote the two alleles, such as PIMZ. Now, the most clinically significant of these will be PIZZ, which has a circulating alpha-1 antitrypsin at levels about 10% of wild-type individuals. When patients have this particular genotype, about 10 to 15% will develop clinical liver disease, which indicates there are other genetic or environmental factors that are involved in disease progression. Another important variant is PIMZ, which is about intermediate between PIZZ and wild-type. Now, there are two different mechanisms that account for the pathologic findings. In the liver, the protein misfolds in the hepatocytes and accumulates, leading to endoplasmic reticulum stress and the unfolded protein response, leading to hepatocyte apoptosis. In the lung, the damage we see is not due to an unfolded protein response, it's due to an inadequate protease inhibitor. This can lead to pan-acinar emphysema. So let's take a look at this, refreshing what you've already learned in the pulmonary chapter of Robbins. This is showing the normal acinus. Here is what we see in pan-acinar emphysema, nicely demonstrated here in this gross specimen. This is in contrast to what we see in centra-acinar emphysema, which is, as you recall, is very closely linked to smoking. So why do we see emphysema in both these conditions? In smoking, centra-acinar emphysema, the toxins in smoke are going to attract neutrophils that are going to release their proteases like elastase. What we see in pan-acinar emphysema is that this is just the general activity of neutrophils in response to pathogens leading to this pan-acinar change. But it's very important for people who have alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency that they not smoke, because that is going to drive them to emphysema very quickly. So what do we see morphologically? Again, in advanced cases, we can see cirrhosis. Microscopically, we can see these deposits of this protein, globular, round-to-oval cytoplasmic inclusions in our hepatocytes. Now, they're difficult to see on H&E stain, but fortunately, we have a stain called periodic acid shift that we can use to highlight these globules. There are other substances in the liver that are PAS positive, so we'll use an enzyme called diastase to dissolve those away. I'll show you an image shortly. The globules tend to begin accumulating in the periportal hepatocytes, but over time will be seen throughout the lobule. Here's a low power view showing a PAS stain, which accounts for this somewhat violet hue. And you can see, again, the classic findings of cirrhosis, nodules of hepatocytes, and bridging fibrosis. Here is an H&E stain, and you can see we've got some inflammation here, but you know, it's really not apparent that there's anything deposited here. There may be a little bit of a globule here, but is that bile? I don't know. Let's do our PAS with diastase, and boom, there you have it, these gorgeous fuchsia globules that can make that diagnosis for you. So the presentation will differ depending on the age of the patient. About 10% of neonates will present with hepatitis with cholestatic jaundice. Adolescents will have symptoms related to either acute hepatitis or cirrhosis, and these are similar to what we've already discussed. Adults may present with full-on cirrhosis, and as I mentioned before, we can get hepatocellular carcinoma. This is seen in about 2-3% of adults with the PIZZ genotype. Unfortunately, we do not have a medical treatment for this, so liver transplantation may be necessary, and as I mentioned earlier, avoidance of cigarette smoking is critical. As always, here are some questions to help you test what you've learned of this material. Thank you very much for your time and attention. Please do subscribe. I sure would appreciate it. Thank you.